Good day, praise the Lord. This is Brother Clinton. Welcome to my living room once again. Today is the second day of the week, the 26th of November, the year of our Lord, 2012, 5773. And I'm going to continue today in the Revelation series that I started a while back. We left off at the end of the seventh chapter, and right now we're going to pick up in the beginning of the eighth chapter. And so may the Lord bless the reading of His holy word. And before I read in the beginning of the eighth chapter, I'm going to read from the first chapter in the third verse. May the Lord bless the reading of this word. He says, "Blessed is he that readeth, and they that hear the words of this prophecy, and keep those things which are written therein, for the time is at hand." And let us keep that admonition and that blessing in mind as we search the scriptures. As I've said before, it's so very important when you read the scripture to understand the scripture by the scripture, and of course by the Spirit of the Lord, and not to get your understanding of the scripture from some theological book or some commentary written by some scholar. Not that there aren't things to be gleaned from those things, not that there aren't semblances of truth in those things, but we don't need those things. We're not commanded of God to obtain those things. What we are commanded of God to do is to search the scriptures and to meditate in His law day and night, and of course to do those things that are written therein, and then we shall make our way prosperous, and then we shall have good success. So when you're reading the book of the Revelation, as any other book in the Bible, the way that you're going to understand the book of the Revelation is to have an understanding of the rest of the Bible. Okay, John, the man to whom this revelation was given, was not a scholar or a theologian. He was a Jewish man. He was a disciple of the Lord Jesus Christ. And the things that he understood when he received this revelation, and the things that the churches understood when John gave it to them, were understood by them because they understood the scripture. If you don't understand Genesis, you're not going to understand Revelation. If you don't understand Exodus and Leviticus, you're not going to understand the revelation. So the revelation of Jesus Christ is not understood by the theological works of men or the videos of prophecy teachers in these last days. It is understood by the rest of the scripture. Praise the Lord. So let's also keep that in mind as we continue. We're going to begin in Revelation chapter 8, verse 1. May the Lord bless the reading of His word. "And when he had opened the seventh seal, there was silence in heaven about the space of half an hour." Okay. Now I'm not going to go back too much because we've already talked about a lot of these things beforehand, but I'm going to go back a little bit just to give a little bit of background. But remember, there was a book with seven seals in the fifth chapter of the Revelation. It was written that, as John said, "I saw in the right hand of him that sat on the throne a book written within and on the backside, sealed with seven seals." And this book was given to the Lamb, okay, the Lamb of God. "And one of the elders saith unto me, Weep not, behold, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the root of David, hath prevailed to open the book and to loose the seven seals thereof. And I beheld, and lo, in the midst of the throne and of the four beasts and in the midst of the elders stood a lamb as it had been slain." And this is Revelation 5, verses 5 and 6. "Having seven horns and seven eyes, which are the seven spirits of God sent forth into all the earth." And I explained all these things in my study on the Revelation, the fifth chapter, and you're welcome to go back and look at that if you like. This Lamb of God, who is Jesus Christ, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the Son of the living God, prevailed. And it says in verse 9, "And they sung a new song, saying, Thou art worthy to take the book and to open the seals thereof. For thou wast slain and hast redeemed us to God by thy blood out of every kindred and tongue and people and nation, and hast made us unto our God kings and priests, and we shall reign on the earth." And so the Lamb of God took the book from him that sat upon the throne, and he began to open the seals. And when the seals were opened, judgments came forth. And the first four of these judgments were the first four horsemen that we read of: the white horse, the red horse, the black horse, and the pale horse. And then the fifth seal was opened, and we saw under the altar the souls of them that were slain for the word of God. And then the sixth seal was opened, and there was a great earthquake, John said. And the sun became black as sackcloth of hair, and the moon became as blood. And the stars of heaven fell unto the earth, even as a fig tree casteth her untimely figs when she is shaken of a mighty wind, even as the Lord Jesus Christ said himself. We can read in Luke chapter 21, Matthew chapter 24, and Mark chapter 13. About these things. "And the heaven departed as a scroll when it is rolled together, and every mountain and island were moved out of their places, and the kings of the earth, and the great men, and the rich men, and the chief captains, and the mighty men, and every bondman, and every free man, hid themselves in the dens and in the rocks of the mountains, and said to the mountains and rocks, Fall on us, and hide us from the face of him that sitteth on the throne, and from the wrath of the Lamb. For the great day of his wrath is come, and who shall be able to stand?" That's the end of Revelation chapter 6. Okay, so now in chapter 8, the seventh seal is about to be opened. Excuse me, the seventh seal has been opened. And it says, "When he had opened the seventh seal, there was silence in heaven about the space of half an hour." Now, I've heard many commentaries about why there was silence in heaven about the space of half an hour. One man even went so far as to say, he's one of those professional entertainers, and he went so far as to say, "Well, we know by this verse of scripture that there were no women in heaven." I can't believe I went there. Yes, I went there. Okay. But we know that that's not the case. But I believe that it's obvious that the reason that there was silence in heaven that space of a half an hour is because the silence accompanies the opening of the seventh seal, and a time of reverence and of awe and of waiting in heaven for what was going to come next. And so it says, "And when he had opened the seventh seal, there was silence in heaven about the space of half an hour." So it's like an awesome, reverent hush that has come over all the kingdom of heaven to wait and see what's going to come next. Now, this seventh seal, having been opened, makes the way for a different set of judgments. And these judgments are signified by the blowing of trumpets, which is what we're about to see. May God help me to speak English. Blessed be the name of the Lord. "And I saw the seven angels which stood before God," verse 2, Revelation chapter 8, verse 2. "And I saw the seven angels which stood before God, and to them were given seven trumpets." Okay. "And another angel came and stood at the altar, having a golden censer. And there was given unto him much incense, that he should offer it with the prayers of all saints upon the golden altar, which was before the throne." Okay, those of us who know the scripture, we understand that God gave instructions to Moses to build a tabernacle in the wilderness, and also to David to have his son Solomon build a temple in Jerusalem. And that temple and that tabernacle were built after the same pattern, because it was the pattern that God gave to Moses in the mount. And he said, "See that thou makest all things after the pattern which was shown to thee in the mount." Okay, it's written in the book of Hebrews and also in the book of Exodus that God said that to Moses. This tabernacle was made a certain way on purpose. And there was a golden altar, and we can read about that in the 30th chapter of Exodus, how God told Moses to build that golden altar. And that golden altar was not the altar of burnt sacrifice where they would burn animal sacrifices. It was specifically for the burning of incense, and only a specific kind of incense. And also in Exodus chapter 30, the scripture talks about how they were to make that incense. And the scripture makes very clear that, number one, they were to burn nothing on that altar except incense, and only that kind of incense. And number two, they were not to make that incense or that kind of incense for any other purpose except for burning on that altar. Okay, and if anyone made some incense that was like that to put on himself to make himself smell like that, he would be cast out from the people of Israel. Okay, so it was very specific instructions that God gave to Moses about this. And that incense represented the prayers of saints. And at that particular time, that altar was separated from the throne of God or the mercy seat by a veil. And only one man, once a year, could go behind that veil, and that was the high priest, and he had to have the blood of animals to do it. And he brought incense in there in a censer to put incense on the censer and cause the smoke of the incense to come up and be a shield between him and the glory of God. And that was a figure of what was to come, and it was to represent the prayers of the saints. Okay, let's read verse 3 again. "And another angel came and stood at the altar." Now these seven angels appeared, and each of them was given a trumpet. So they had seven trumpets. "And now another angel came and stood at the altar." Okay, and this is the golden altar that is before the throne. Okay, the reason that the tabernacle and the temple were built like they were in the earth is because they were an exact replica of the one that is in heaven. At least as far as their design, they were an exact replica. Please pardon the noise of my landscapers. That's what's going on outside in the background. Okay, so another angel came and stood at the altar. In heaven there is a temple, and there is the throne of God, and then there is the golden altar of incense that is before the throne. Okay, another angel came and stood at the altar, having a golden censer. Okay, and a censer is a little portable jar or bucket or a container that can contain coals of fire so that you can put incense on it. and the smoke of the incense comes up. Okay, so this angel came and stood at the altar, and he had a golden censer in his hand. And there was given unto him much incense, that he should offer it with the prayers of all saints upon the golden altar which was before the throne. Okay, the prayers of all saints. Throughout the ages, there were saints that have prayed unto the Lord when they were persecuted, when they were downtrodden, when they were oppressed. And it seemed to them at times that their prayers were not being heard, but that's not the case. Their prayers were heard. In fact, in some places in the scripture, the Bible says that their prayers were kept in a bottle, that their prayers were stored until a certain time when they would be released and answered perfectly. Jesus Christ, the Son of God, prayed while he was on the cross, saying, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? Well, his God had not forsaken him. The will of his God was being done. And that prayer did not go unheard, even though God didn't come down and loose his Son, Jesus Christ, from the cross. That prayer did not go unheard. Neither did your prayers go unheard when you were persecuted or forsaken or downtrodden. Even though you might not have seen the Almighty God come and vindicate you at that moment, your prayer did not go unheard. Your prayer was heard of God, and it was stored, and it will be released at a certain time. In this particular time right here, the prayers of all saints that have been persecuted, that have been thrown to the lions, that have been sewn up in bags with serpents and scorpions inside and cast into the sea, that have been beheaded, that have had their heads impaled on stakes, that have been sawn asunder, that have been burned at the stake, that have been tortured and killed in various ways, the prayers of these saints have been stored up for a specific time and for a specific purpose. And that is what's going on in Revelation chapter 8, verse 3. And another angel came and stood at the altar, having a golden censer, and there was given unto him much incense. Okay, I believe it's in Psalm 42 that says, let my prayer come up before thee as incense. That he should offer it with the prayers of all saints upon the golden altar which was before the throne. Okay, so now all these prayers of the saints from all the centuries and all the millennia are coming up before God at his throne. Verse 4, and the smoke of the incense which came with the prayers of the saints ascended up before God out of the angel's hand. Blessed be the name of the Lord. So now all these cries of the saints from all the centuries are coming up before God. Verse 5, and the angel took the censer and filled it with fire of the altar and cast it into the earth. And there were voices and thunderings and lightnings and an earthquake. Now I want to share something with you from the 16th chapter of Leviticus, and this is where the scripture is talking about the Day of Atonement. The priest would make atonement for the children of Israel once a year. And part of that was in verse 12, Leviticus 16:12. It says, and he, the priest, shall take a censer full of burning coals of fire from off the altar before the Lord, and his hands full of sweet incense, beaten small, and bring it within the veil. And he shall put the incense upon the fire before the Lord, that the cloud of the incense may cover the mercy seat that is upon the testimony, that he die not. So the priest was commanded to take a censer and fill it with fire from the altar. And then when he went behind the veil, he was to put the incense on that fire in the censer in order to cause a cloud of smoke to come up to be a sweet savor before the Lord and to shield him from the glory of God so that he would not die. Well, over here in the Revelation chapter 8, verse 5, like we just read, the angel took his censer and filled it with the fire of the altar, but he didn't put incense on it and bring it before the Lord. What did he do? He cast it into the earth. Because it's not about saving the lives of the people anymore. It's about bringing destruction upon them. And so now the prayers of the saints are not to shield the priest from the Lord so that he doesn't die. Now the prayers of the saints are to remind God of his fury and his wrath and to incense him even further so that his wrath can be even more acute to come upon the sons and daughters of men on the face of the earth. And this is what is happening in this vision that John saw. And it's going to happen just like this. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. So let's go on to verse 6. Revelation 8, 6. And the seven angels which had the seven trumpets prepared themselves to sound. Okay. So now all this has happened. The angel has done this that he did. Took fire of the altar and cast it into the earth in the censer. And there were voices and thunderings and lightnings and an earthquake. And this is why there was silence in heaven for about the space of half an hour while all heaven was standing there in awe and in wonder, wondering what God was going to do next. And now verse 6 says, and the seven angels which had the seven trumpets prepared themselves to sound. How majestic a sight. How awesome a thing that God has prepared for these last days. And after the seven seals have been opened, the seventh seal unleashes the judgments of the seven trumpets. And the first one is about to sound. Verse 7, the first angel sounded, and there followed hail and fire mingled with blood. That sounds like something that God did in Egypt when he brought wonders great and powerful upon Pharaoh and upon all Egypt when Pharaoh refused to let his people go. But it's going to be even more intense than that. The first angel sounded, and there followed hail and fire mingled with blood, and they were cast upon the earth, and the third part of trees was burnt up, and all green grass was burnt up. On a third part of the earth, hail and fire mingled with blood. Imagine that. Imagine next time that you're out and you're at the mall, or you're at a crowded bus station, or wherever a bunch of people are gathered together, and they're laughing and they're smiling and they're thinking that everything's going to be the same tomorrow as it is today, and they can just continue in their sins, and they can just continue to invent God however they want him to be, or reject God altogether, and they think that all is well. Imagine how the looks are going to be on their faces when all of a sudden out of the sky comes hail and fire mixed with blood upon a third of all the earth. And the third part of trees are burned up and all the green grass is burned up. Let's go back to the book of Joel in the Old Testament. Joel chapter 1, verses 18 and 19. It says, how do the beasts groan? The herds of cattle are perplexed because they have no pasture. Yea, the flocks of sheep are made desolate. Lord, to thee will I cry, for the fire hath devoured the pastures of the wilderness, and the flame hath burned all the trees of the field. The beasts of the field cry also unto thee, for the rivers of waters are dried up, and the fire hath devoured the pastures of the wilderness. In God's hand is the power to do all these things, and he will do these things. Just because we don't see the mighty power of God on the earth right now destroying things is not because God is weak or because he has fallen asleep. It is because of his mercy, because God is long-suffering, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. But even as the mighty power of God was established on the earth in the days when Moses delivered the children of Israel out of Egypt, so shall it be again, and even many more fold, in the days when the wrath of Jesus Christ is revealed from heaven. And this is what we're reading about, which will be happening soon. Hallelujah. So the first angel sounded, and those things happened. And verse 8 says, and the second angel sounded, and as it were a great mountain burning with fire was cast into the sea. And the third part of the sea became blood. And the third part of the creatures which were in the sea and had life died. And the third part of the ships were destroyed. Praise the Lord. Imagine, if you will, the biggest, mightiest ship that man ever has made capsizing in the middle of the ocean, and how mighty and powerful that would be. If you were on that ship, how helpless you would be. And if you were in a boat a mile away from that ship, watching that big monster turn over, and in the mighty waves of the sea being caught up and capsizing and being swallowed up into the sea, what an awesome, majestic, marvelous, terrible sight that would be. And yet a mountain could be 10 or 20 or 100 times the size of that ship. And the Bible says that, as it were, a great mountain burning with fire were cast into the sea. Imagine all those people again, gathered together doing the things that they do, and eating and drinking and marrying and giving in marriage, and all of a sudden the judgment of God comes, and a great mountain burning with fire is cast into the sea, and the third part of the sea, of the whole world, became blood. And the third part of the creatures which were in the sea and had life died, and the third part of the ships were destroyed. And the third angel sounded, and there fell a great star from heaven, burning as it were a lamp, and it fell upon the third part of the rivers and upon the fountains of waters. And the name of the star is called Wormwood. And the third part of the waters became wormwood, and many men died of the waters because they were made bitter. This word wormwood causes a lot of confusion, and you can study it out if you want and find out what the word means and do an etymology on the word, but it really doesn't matter. It's obvious that it's something that is bitter and poison. Okay, what does the word bitter mean? Many men died of the waters because they were made bitter. Well, we can see from the verse of Scripture that the word bitter means more than just something that has a little bit of a bitter taste to it. Okay, because they died from the waters. You don't die from something that tastes a little bit bitter. But in this particular instance, the English word bitter means that it was poison. And we can see this elsewhere in the Scripture too. If we go back to the book of Exodus, right when the children of Israel had come across the Red Sea, and they came to the waters that were bitter. Exodus 15:23, and when they came to Marah, they could not drink of the waters of Marah, for they were bitter. Therefore the name of it was called Marah. And the people murmured against Moses, saying, "What shall we drink?" Okay, they were in the desert. They were thirsty. They needed something to drink, and they couldn't drink the waters because they were bitter. It wasn't because they tasted a little bitter. It was because they were poisoned. And he cried unto the Lord, and the Lord showed him a tree, which when he had cast into the waters were made sweet. Okay, it doesn't mean that they tasted sweet. It means that they were clean. It means they were free from the poison. Of course, there's a difference in the taste of the water when there's no poison in it, but it wasn't a difference between bitter and sweet like the difference between a lemon and an orange. There's a difference between poison and fresh. There he made for them a statute and an ordinance, and there he proved them, and said, "If thou wilt diligently hearken to the voice of the Lord thy God, and wilt do that which is right in his sight, and wilt give ear to his commandments, and keep all his statutes, I will put none of these diseases upon thee, which I have brought upon the Egyptians, for I am the Lord that healeth thee." So he healed the water so that there was no disease in it, so that there was no death in it, and the water was called bitter because it was poison. And that's the same thing that John was talking about in the Revelation 8, verse 11, when he says, many men died of the waters because they were made bitter. Okay. Now, the fourth angel sounded, verse 12. And the third part of the sun was smitten, and the third part of the moon, and the third part of the stars. So as the third part of them was darkened, and the day shone not for a third part of it, and the night likewise. And I beheld and heard an angel flying through the midst of heaven, saying with a loud voice, "Woe, woe, woe to the inhabitants of the earth, by reason of the other voices of the trumpet of the three angels which are yet to sound." So four of these angels have sounded, four of the trumpets have been blown, four judgments have come forth, and three are left. And woe unto the inhabitants of the earth who will experience those things. Now let me point something out to you that's kind of interesting. I'm on the earth, and I'm in Phoenix, Arizona. It's daytime. There are other people on the earth that are in Hong Kong. It's nighttime there. It's 15 hours later there than it is here. If something happens in the heavens on this side of the earth where I am and I look up to see it, the people in Hong Kong are likely not going to see it because they're when they look up into the heavens, they're looking the opposite direction. Okay? So it's possible for something to happen in the heavens that is seen and experienced in one part of the earth and not on the rest of the earth. And in these four judgments, these four trumpet judgments, we see that the word third is used there much, very much. The first angel sounded, and hail and fire mingled with blood, and they were cast upon the earth, and the third part of trees was burnt up. The third part of trees, and all green grass was burnt up. The second angel sounded, and a great mountain burning with fire was cast into the sea, and the third part of the sea became blood. The third angel sounded, and there fell a star from heaven, burning as it were a lamp, and it fell upon the third part of the rivers and upon the fountains of waters. Okay, and the name of that star was Wormwood, and it made the waters bitter, and the men died when they drank it. And the fourth angel sounded, and the third part of the sun was smitten, and the third part of the moon, and the third part of the stars, so as the third part of them was darkened. And the day shone not for a third part of it, and the night likewise. Okay, well, how did the night not shine? Well, remember, God made two lights, the greater light to rule the day and the lesser light to rule the night. There are lights at night. There are the moon and the stars. And Jesus said in the Gospel according to Luke, if we could just go over there real quick, Luke chapter 21, I believe it's verse 35. No. Verse 25. Luke chapter 1, verse 25. Jesus said, "And there shall be signs in the sun, and in the moon, and in the stars, and upon the earth distress of nations, with perplexity, the sea and the waves roaring." Isn't that what we just read about in the 8th chapter of the book of Revelation? "Men's hearts failing them for fear, and for looking after those things which are coming on the earth, for the powers of heaven shall be shaken, and then shall they see the Son of Man coming in a cloud with power and great glory." So when we see these things happening in the 8th chapter of the Revelation, these things are going to happen just before the Son of Man is revealed from heaven. And that's why the book that we're reading is called The Revelation of Jesus Christ. Because it's about the things that are going to happen when Jesus Christ is revealed to the world. Hallelujah. So these things affected or will be affecting a third of the world. Now I want to show you something. this is my atlas, okay? And this is a map of the world. This is Israel, right here. It's no coincidence that Israel is pretty much in the middle of everything, in the center of the world, okay? If something happened right over Israel, and these judgments happened right over Israel, these judgments that we just read about, okay? The trumpets that we just read about, hail and fire mingled with blood, a great mountain burning with fire cast into the sea, the star called Wormwood cast into the river's waters to take all the rivers and change them into bitter waters that make men dead. And in the heavens, all of a sudden there's no sun and no moon and no stars. If all those things were to happen right over Jerusalem, right over Israel, they would take out a third of the whole world. Okay? If you count Africa and Eurasia together, you've got about a third of the world's landmass. If you take the Indian Ocean right here, and maybe spilling over into the Pacific and the Atlantic Ocean right here, that's about a third of the world's water. And if you take the rivers that are on this landmass right here, and you make them bitter and you poison them, that's about a third of the waters of the world that anybody has to drink or live on. So this is about a third of the world right here. And if these things happen and the sun was darkened and the moon was darkened in the heavens right over this area, it would be over about a third of the world. Now these people over here would be on the other side of the world and they wouldn't necessarily be able to see that right then, but this part of the world right here would be experiencing that darkness in the heavens, and they wouldn't be able to see the sun or the moon. The moon would be turned into blood, and the waters, the sea, would be turned into blood, and everything in the sea that had life died, and the ships that were in the sea perished, and all the rivers of these lands were turned into bitter water so that no man could drink them except they die. This is a third of the world right here, right in here, right in here. Here's Israel right here. Africa, the Middle East, Europe, Asia, Russia, India, China, all these countries right here. How many people do you think are packed into those few areas of land? This little area of land right here, about the size of my fingertip, is India. There are a billion people there, a billion, three times the population of the United States in India, right here, this thing about the size of the tip of my finger. And all these people are going to be experiencing these judgments that Jesus told John about in the book of the Revelation in chapter 8. And these first four judgments. And yet, the last verse of chapter 8 says, I beheld and heard an angel flying through the midst of heaven, saying with a loud voice, Woe, woe, woe to the inhabitants of the earth, by reason of the other voices of the trumpet of the three angels, which are yet to sound. Hallelujah. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge. The fear of the Lord makes men depart from evil. If you don't fear the Lord, you know nothing. If you don't fear the Lord, you have no scruples. If you don't fear the Lord, you have no discipline. If you don't fear the Lord, you have nothing. You have nothing. The Lord is worthy that he should be feared and revered, and that men should bow down before him. And the people of this world who refuse to bow down before him, or refuse to know him according to his word, but insist on imagining him the way they want him to be, these are the judgments that are waiting for them. The people in the various denominations, the people on the broad path that leadeth to destruction, the people in the mainstream, the people that invent their Jesus the way they want him to be, and invent their religion the way they want it to be, and reject the word of God, and reject the King of Heaven, and reject the word that he sends by his prophets. This is what is waiting for those people. And as we get into the ninth chapter in a different video, we're going to see those other three judgments, or the beginning of those other three judgments that the angel just warned the people about. Blessed be the name of the Lord, and blessed be he that readeth, and they that keep the words of this prophecy, for the time is at hand.